What would we do as a civilization if we found evidence for intelligent alien life? How would we deal with it? If that day ever arrives, it would undoubtedly be the biggest discovery in human history. We are the most intelligent species on Earth, and most likely the second of the chimps. We share about 99% of our DNA with chimpanzees, and we cannot communicate with them. Is it hubris to even imagine we could communicate with an alien species billions of years ahead of us?
Suppose the difference between humans and chimps is as small as a 0.5% DNA in the intelligence vector, whatever that vector is. Suppose it is that small. What do you say? Well, what do you mean? We have the Hubble telescope and poetry and philosophy, and they stick a twig in a hole to get termites out. Maybe the difference between those is small. You don't want to think that way, but imagine it. So now let's imagine an alien who is 5% along that same vector beyond us that we are beyond the chimp. What would we look like to them? No reason for me to think that we wouldn't look any different to them that chimps look to us. So, and that's 0.5%. So now imagine 5%, 10%. Their simplest expression of an idea would transcend our smartest capacity to comprehend. So I think about this all the time, leaving me to wonder whether the search for intelligent life, SETI, is itself a bit of hubris, because it assumes that some other species has our intelligence and not something so far beyond us that they would take no interest in who and what we are. And one of the solutions to the Fermi paradox is that we are to the aliens what worms are to us. So one of them is that they've studied Earth and there's no sign of intelligent life.
The cosmos is filled with trillions of stars. There are about 100,000 million stars in the Milky Way alone. Many of them are just like our own sun. Based on that number, it would seem we are most certainly not alone in the galaxy, let alone in the universe. So where are all the aliens? As far as our civilization has come technologically, we are nowhere near of reaching the stars. The spacecraft that is travelling the fastest is NASA's Parker Solar Probe. After it launched from Earth in 2018, it skimmed the sun's scorching atmosphere and used the sun's gravity to reach up to 163 kilometers per second. For our standards, that's extremely fast, but for it to reach the nearest star from the sun, Proxima Centauri, it would take close to 8,000 years. It takes light, the fastest thing there is in the universe, about 4.2 years to reach Proxima Centauri. And there lies the problem. Space. It's unimaginably vast. If our descendants want to venture to the distant stars, they will have to invent new means for space travel. In physics, a tunnel with two ends at separate points in space-time is known as a wormhole. But the lack of evidence for intelligent aliens is either telling us that they are extremely rare, if not non-existent, or that wormholes are not physically possible. Even with our current technologies, it is estimated that our own galaxy, the Milky Way, can be colonized within less than a billion years. So if an alien civilization with our current capabilities started colonizing the galaxy a billion years ago, we should see signs of their presence by now. And if that was the case, then with the words of the famous physicist Enrico Fermi, where is everybody?
My favorite explanation for the Fermi paradox, it's whatever drive is required for you to want to, quote, colonize planets with abandon, right? You go to a planet, you have offspring, and they colonize two planets, and they go two planets. Whatever that drive is, has the seeds of its own unraveling built within it. Because what happens when the planets start becoming scarce? Your urge to do this, risking life and limb, that means it's deep in you. You need that planet. You want that planet. And so you go out and then there's somebody else trying to claim the planet. And then you have interstellar warfare competing over the limited real estate of the planets in the galaxy. Is the same urges that infused colonial Europe. So here you have Spain, Portugal, England, and they all want to conquer the world. So initially they have their own territory, but then they encounter each other. And then the entire system implodes because they can't share it, because in them they want to own it. And so this notion has already played out in this world. And that was the implosion of Europe and its colonistic ways, going from the age of the great explorers to the age of the great collapse of the colonial empires. So it's not a stretch to imagine this as sort of a fundamental truth without having to analyze the psychological profile of the alien.
Proxima Centauri B is the closest potentially habitable exoplanet to Earth. It is orbiting in the habitable zone of the red dwarf star Proxima Centauri. It's believed to be possibly Earth-like planet that orbits within the habitable zone of its star. The planet's proximity to Earth offers an opportunity for robotic space exploration. At a speed between 15% and 20% of the speed of light, it would take between 20 and 30 years to complete the journey, and approximately 4 years for a return message from the starship to Earth. It seems for the time being the best chance to encounter alien life is for them to visit us. Until, and if that day arrives, we are left with guesswork. But to understand how alien life might emerge, we can look at the history of life on Earth.
If you rank order the abundance of chemical elements in the universe, the number one element is hydrogen. The number two is helium, which is not chemically active, but it's there, but it's a big number two. Number three is oxygen. Number four is carbon. Number five is nitrogen. One other fact, which is not often cited, but it has to be in the equation, is, you know, the earliest fossil evidence comes in around 3.8 billion years ago, and Earth began 4.5, 4.6. So for the longest while, decades, people subtracted those two numbers and said, all right, life took 600 million years. That's still pretty fast, given that we're 4.5 billion years old, okay? That's still pretty fast. It's small compared to the life expectancy of Earth. But it's even better than that, because the early Earth was subjected to what we call the period of heavy bombardment. There were two such periods. Heavy bombardment, Earth is still, the polite way to say it, is accreting matter from the nascent solar system. The more violent way to put it is being slammed constantly by comets and asteroids because it has a strong gravity in its region. It's clearing out its orbit, and all that material ends up going somewhere and it lands back on Earth. And so the Earth is gaining mass, and by gaining mass, it gains even more gravity. It becomes even better at it. And over that time, Earth's surface is sufficiently pelted that the temperatures prevent the formation of complex molecules. Because under high temperatures, the molecular bonds break. And every time you try to experiment with it, it gets broken apart. So it's not conducive to the experimentations of life. So if you're gonna start the clock, wait until the period of heavy bombardment is over. That's like 4 billion years ago, not 4.6. So now you start the clock. Now Earth has some chance of cooling down and making complex molecules and starting the birth of biochemistry. And there it is. Earth went from organic molecules to self-replicating life within between 1 and 200 million years in the early universe.
If it took life on Earth about 200 million years to go from organic molecules to self-replicating life forms, given the age of the oldest galaxies and the number of stars in the universe, it stands to reason that there is countless alien life out there, although intelligence may be extremely rare. The best explanation for our current understanding of why we don't see alien signs all around us is the great filter hypothesis in the intelligence phase. So the conditions for life to emerge throughout the galaxy and beyond are really there, as the number of stars suggest. But then life encounters a great filter as soon as it's ready to start exploring and colonizing space. This certainly seems plausible given our understanding of our sole data point for life here on Earth. We are more than capable of destroying ourselves many times over, and perhaps on the verge of ultimate great filter of life, self-annihilation. But we will cover that more extensively in another video. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.